you ask proxy, assuming a beginning is not so different from an end. Think twice. The proxy whisper voice is inevitable. Archive, what word do you put it under? Flat dogs, pragmatism on ice. Was written as a contribution for a meeting of neuroscientists and artists who were to discuss falling in love as a study in transitions and thus form taxonomies. It is a work that I have re-performed, playing the role of Ivan Cheng, which I had written for someone else. This is not the only reason that I might look at the documentation that exists of this performance. Images, video, memory. I can see myself in it. Watching someone as myself. You can't see it in frame. But the amplifier sits behind a long row of grasses. And a smaller ladder and a larger ladder are near the trunk of a tall, thin oak, bark clad, limbed over years to grow straight. Shuddering. Dry air. In wind. Ladders. This was all supposed to happen on a concrete-walled floating roof, so Kezia would climb up the ladder into the setting sunlight. She won't. This lawn is soft underfoot. Two manned DSLRs. And a tripod with operator. A photographer works for the shot, ducking behind bushes, taking elevators to rooftops. Lenses switch, a study in transitions. What is turning from what? What possibility will a turn of naming offer? What will it disclose? She will say that her name is Ivan Cheng, and Ivan Cheng holds a clarinet. She hears this, my voice, in her ears, and thus she is as me, speaking, right? I look her in the eyes, and we toast water glasses with a small clink and smile at each other, taking a slow sip of water. This toast deliberately echoes the opening of another performance.
Hello.
Think twice.
My name is Ivan Cheng, and I have never seen an exhibition by the artist Arakawa. Have you? I have read about him though, and seen a scramble of video on the internet.
Drinking to the idea of a return. Another proxy who speaks and sings about returning to the stage, a comeback.
He gets fatter or thinner, or his hair changes, or his clothes change from click to click. The different camera represents him differently. I really like the memory of seeing a video of him walking through the capital city of Georgia. Something like a later war. I think it is something like a symposium or a summit.
And then Keijie repeats the words she hears in her ears. This makes her me. If you too repeat the words you hear, will you be me too? You too?
Frozen moments. Architecture speaks back. Research and leisure. The ruins of our times.
Keisha's voice is amplified by a lapel microphone, and her French Rwandan accent sounds low and warped, emanating sound from the grasses, minor delays across the lawn.
My favorite moment is later in the video when he is by a concrete balcony and groans into the microphone. Let's go to the other side of the river. Actually, let's go to the other side of the river.
Gestures taken from a registration of A. Arakawa's collaborative performance. Gestures conveyed through me.
Actually, let's go to the other side of the river. Actually, let's go to the other side of the river.
Keisha and A not speaking in their mother tongue.
Foghorn noise?
A foghorn noise is named to sound like a ship a notice. The performance ends with manic devotion to a Bichon Frise, rewards, responses, possession,
actually,
hearing words and rhythmic barks. A. Arakawa's work reappears
and
reviews as on an ice rink, slipping away, colliding.
Actually,
looking across the sky.
Let's go to the other side
a plane
of the
ice,
river.
And an ending about still calling Australia home, a song that advertises a national airline when sung by youths in white shirts and black pants.
What even is gesture without language?
Audience drifts. As a passage of a gamban on the gag of gesture is recited, will the performer stumble over the translated words before naming the microphone and in-ear relays as prosthesis on Keisha's face, a mask in her mouth which goes to her ears, a gag on her free speech?
And a list of titles follow. Another different rhythm, potential names, potential ways to align gestures to categorize. I won't intone the whole list now. Some I like still are petrol on ice, or labored futurity, or two Shinto shrines, a tear of petrol is in your eye, or which floor, which ceiling, or staircases on ice. I'm flying, I'm skating. You see me in an archive. What is it that I'm looking at? And what is it that you're looking at? Accumulations, time, order. Phantom cigarette. This is skin, this is a limb. What is the inside? Inside the boxes. Dribbling pork, crackling, tendering to crisp over a hot plate, or scaling out the plate into a point, the hot point, not hot plate, the hot tip, which is the burning end of a lit fag. Points of skin hardening, the rapid aging of having a lighter, a gas lighter, the dot of fire burning under the point of skin, or the dot of smolder on the tip of the phantom cigarette burning into skin as you suck. Suction of climate through the filter of papers and detritus, through that climax between your fingers, the distinctive whirls. Pork. Crackling into snacks to crumble from your lips, crackled in spots, pigskin marbled with fat, blistering pork, crackling, mashing between my lips. Where did it go? Where is my patch? Where is my box of pork crackling, trying to stop, pretending to stop, a hot breath exhale of tobacco and pigskin? Fingers stained. Trappings under nails. Nails in the coffin. Gilles Deleuze has longer fingernails because he doesn't cut them. What's his body matter to what he is thinking? If I can't name what is inside the cigarette, maybe I can talk about what's different on the outside of this one. Smoking talk. Gilles Deleuze responds in Letter to a Harsh Critic that I haven't got the normal protective whirls, so that touching anything, especially fabric, causes such irritation that I need long nails to protect them. Or one might say, and it's true, that I dream of being not invisible but imperceptible. And the closest I can get to the dream is having fingernails I can keep in my pockets. So I find nothing more disconcerting than somebody looking at them. It's strange, anyway, how none of my friends have ever commented on my nails, finding them perfectly natural. As though they just landed there like seeds blown in the wind that nobody bothers mentioning. Curling, long, cursive. Pressure, fold back, recurs, seeds, blown in the wind, fertile hopes for harvest, dreams, assumed honesty, this in response to critique received of his person, his body, his fingernails compared to Greta Garbo's dark glasses, a prosthesis hovering on the bridge of nose, eyes masked, a ring of smoke moving through a windless office. Shaded views, encircling. Gilles Deleuze has expressive hands, animated in speech acts, at least those filmed and archived. In mythologies, Roland Barthes writes of Garbo having expressive eyes, tremulous black wounds, and the thick snow of makeup masking her otherwise face. A mask is but a sound. Above all, their thematic harmony. A long set of nails as a pair of tinted glasses, shrouds, protective, aging, dark glasses. The essence you want to receive is not there. More cameras? Snowy, solitary Greta Garbo. It is as though by being documented she turns into a divine corpse. How responsible should I be about exhuming these corpses? Testament, testimony, documents melting in heat. Cigarettes burnt by a flame. I recently biked across ice and a flurry of snow to a dinner party. A variation on a configuration that I had anecdotally drawn from in December 2016 for Dogged Adorning, a performance about relationships as value-added commodities. I brushed off the cold flakes and chatted to my host. I apologize for digressions from my testimony, any fictions. I'm obviously trying to achieve something with the writing of the event, the documenting of this moment. Fusion cuisine over a few courses, pork crackling as an ingredient, shocking flavor and texture for someone unfamiliar like me, almost like nail clippings, big nail clippings, prawns, goat cheese, vermicelli, coriander, pork crackling, cucumber rolled in rice paper, comments rolling around the table, a horny old man who apparently has a thing for the Orient. Rice, paper, rolls, cracked paper, moisten and soften. The conversation turns glibly to national EU and US politics. One guest speaks in accented English, and another voice in accented English responds by pretending he can't understand any of their words. He says, "I don't understand your sign language." By which I think he means the hand gestures made. I'm left thinking a lot about what it means to mute the speech act and divert all attention to the body. Not to mention misattribution of signaling. An uncontrolled, undisciplined set of hand gestures which only wanted to illustrate or be emphatic, not bear meaning. So, the man who says he is receiving signs performs a downward gaze, unless the hands drifted up to the eyes, and he averts his ears, averts our attention from words that we negotiate and share. How flip, how rude, but how do I feel now upon returning to the thought? Aren't I in favor of pre-linguistic gesture? Smokescreen of language, erased condescension. Perhaps my rage came from the misidentification of what could even pass as sign language, the hammy pantomime. Pretending that something resembles something, smoke in the eyes, watering eyes, blurry blind. The thing you're hoping to see is not there. I'm reminded of part of the concluding passage from Finality's An Ashtray, a performance from June 2015, which claimed to be interested in collisions and standards. Tamsaka Judgy was part of a group who necklaced two men caught with a stolen television. Judgy explains it as mob justice, though necklacing, which is to place a car tire around a human neck and set them on fire, was more common during the struggle against apartheid by blacks on blacks. Tamsaka Judgy was accused of signing gibberish during a memorial service for Nelson Mandela. Judgy explains it as his seeing angels fly into the stadium and being astonished. Sign language. The choreographer Sarah Mitchelson speaks about devotion. Morning, noon, and night. Morning, noon, and night. What is silence? Or what is it to speak in other people's voices? What is it to speak in other people's tongues? This film, Phantom Cigarette, is to be screened in a setting where my body appears, projected, surrounded by a ringed stadium of words, a diagram of performance art contexts, which is in German but makes sense to an English reader for the names it includes. I want the idea of being caught with a stolen television to reverberate. I want you to think of the ring of the tire burning. I want to be responsible to the politics and violence that I rapidly conjure with the act of necklacing. Violence should not be worn lightly. Care should be taken. My words should be fallacies to my intention. I don't wish to sign gibberish. I have not chosen to be imperceptible. I wish to give enough context. You should always ask for more. Necklacing is masking the face with burning rubber. The least you get away with are severe burns and crackling to the face. A smoke screen indeed, burning, obscured gaze. Come with me. Greta Garbo's dark glasses, gibberish and wounds. Soul bearing, garbo garbic, face shielded by a handbag, retreat from public. What is the thing that you wanted to see? What did you expect to learn from watching this? And what do you really get? Violent axe. What to see? Bono in sunglasses? Walls? A smoke screen? Papery skin is a wall. Dividing. Obscuring.
This is the sound of my apartment in Amsterdam, though it is only in the background. I live in the center on the Oudezijds Achterbergval, where I've invited artists to work over the last year, a space confused by moving into a spectrum of public and private archive. It's temporary, all temporary anyway. I spent a while thinking not of exhibitions or collections, but of harvesting, a hungry gathering of what's there or seems ripe with an implied disregarding of the roots, to return to something from before. It's the tips, ends of Deleuze's nails, the floating seeds that just landed over his fingertips. The extended metaphor for the project space lies in the idea of gathering hay or straw, I think, mass industrial, the reading of metaphor, rather than something more painfully specific, to depart from possession rimming. Perhaps I'm interested in thinking of metaphor as impermanent, repurposed architecture. Can you hear it in the background?
Thick, clear plastic, bag with scrunched pink paper in this hand and a lead pencil hidden in my other fist. This is a fountain. This is a fountain pen, not a gavel. This is the rigorock, the ending.
With a straw, I lean over the petrol tank of the car and suck a deep mouthful. My gag reflex is steadied. I won't spit the mix back in. I hold the mouthful of petroleum ethanol in my mouth and spit it into the recycled water bottle in my hand. It's a cool taste. Almost like menthol. Like a menthol. Different to diesel. Pig in a wig. It's different. Tankers across Europe. Truckers driving oil. Pipeline flow. Not so many cars on the canals. The petrol, it was warmer than I thought in the cool. The streets are lined with bags. 2 days of white snow turning into slush. Rare in February. And upcoming days of balmy sunlight so that all that spills from our mouths are cries of spring. Drinking petrol may lead to breathing difficulties, throat pain, burning in the esophagus, abdominal pain, vision loss, vomiting with blood and bloody stools. Spring, spring, city spring, uprising, 2 doors up on my canal. It's a fraternity house. Temporary and legacy, boys, men, and, or at least, that's the studious transition we expect. When fall breaks, and they induct themselves to a fraternas, they wear white shirts and black trousers while drinking in the dusk. A shout from the second floor, and a chorus cheers from the canal front. So many men shaking hands and shaking beers. Smoking, 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 smoking meats. Yelling, I'm almost graduating again. Then cheer the shout from the second floor, and a young man leaps out, caught by his brothers, and carried up the street with cries aloud and flares are lit, fizzling and sparkling. His caught body surfs up the canal pavement, held aloft towards lit flares, sparkling and fizzling up the river. Boorish behavior, ritual performance, undocumented experience, private public codes, falling out of the window, falling off the ladder, falling off the wagon. In some work environments, we say that smoking is the only excuse that seems viable for claiming time in which we aren't working. My parents think I am always working, and often I am. So they don't expect me to be constantly in touch. It's been so long since I've seen my parents that I almost forgot that they disapprove of my smoking and that of my friends too. I'm going to see them in April, the first block of time in approaching 2 years. And I don't think I'll smoke then. There's a stopover in Bangkok where maybe I can buy duty-free on the way back. Smoking is okay. Some glibly say that especially with specific zones in which you can smoke, it functions as a gesture that opens social possibility across defined roles. Democratizing. The only thing you can give to a problem, to another, is time. There's nothing else to be given.
It is the gift.
Precedence, precedence, setting it up. I went to a club and danced until it closed. I proceeded to talk about it each day until I had a bath. Days later, I didn't bathe for days. And I lay dozing in the bathtub, a bath of skin from around my fingernails rubbed off my arms. My hair swam around me totally. The cigarette smoke freed and washed the dry stench of cigarettes from my hair. Should have moisturized to keep from drying out, I guess. I went dancing again and still my hair smells of the cigarette. I think of each hair as a smoke, Medusa-like, fragrance penetrating, cracked structure, scalp flaking too. Walls coming down. Arteseis Achterbergwald, where I live, translates to the old side behind the city wall. Limits. City limits. Rings, canals, petrol burning through linings, streets paved with gold. The history of Holland.
Vision loss, breathing difficulties, throat pain, burning in the esophagus, abdominal pain, downwards, downwards, dredging up more land, sinking underwater, lapping at the edges. After the Treaty of Versailles was signed, the city of Cologne is demilitarized. And walls come down, the rings of a stadium which crossed the old city walls, Mungesdorfer Stadium. Now also dismantled, a stadium, a ring, constituents fluttering, loaded. What's to be watched? U2 toured the Joshua Tree album 1987, the first in which the necessity for fans to see their likenesses is such that the video screens added to the tour rider, monitors, monitoring, focusing on the stars, what we pay to see, capacity, rings, rings, crowds of bodies in a stadium, and now, 30 years on, U2 plan a revisiting, a restaging of the album, the Joshua Tree, in its entirety, timeless, or is it timely, filming and streaming performance? U2 are pioneers in stadium spectacle, video in video, pioneers, accumulations, populism, idol, idol, ego, holding in the toxins, taken up can wipe the mouth, wipe the lenses, sanitation, maintenance, addiction. Addiction. This is getting serious. Are you thinking about you or us? In a club filled with smoke, a room of smokers, taking time, hours out of nights, giving time, rock stars, helping? Rock. Rock and roll. Cigarette. Weeping. Cigarette. I'm thinking about mothers. Isn't this what we can always keep in mind? Weeping for Sissy Houston, mighty soul singer who sang backup for Aretha Franklin. It's her trembling voice I hear as I watch a video for Ain't No Way soaring high while Aretha sings. I know that a woman's duty is to help and love a man. And that's the way it was planned. Singing back up on a song written by Aretha's sister. Stop trying to be someone you're not. Aretha sung. A sissy stood in backup. A gospel-y solo vocal. Soaring on a recording that might be distributed for decades to come. Sissy buried her husband, her daughter Whitney, her granddaughter Bobby Christina. Comments in videos speak of mourning, pity, loss, grief, a public lays claim. The audience's claim. Both Whitney and Bobby Christina passed from drowning in bathtubs. It's circulated that this happens in tandem with drug use, cycles and circles compounded with misogynoir, expectations, media hounding. These are bodies that have already been dragged through so much that I shouldn't do the same. Videos exist that document their failures, but videos also exist which celebrate, deify their artistic triumphs. This is a performance archive, but how to approach this in a nuanced, ethical way? More views. More views. Years after Whitney Houston's death, her husband Bobby Brown writes a book with his testimony of Whitney's drug use. Acquitting himself of the blame for her addiction, he reports that prior to the wedding he only drank beer and smoked weed. He, shocked to find her on their wedding day, hunched over a bureau snorting a line of coke, illustrating image of the beautiful couple, resplendent in white, is a man blamed with destroying a singer beloved worldwide. What does he achieve in this book that takes name from the song that won him institutional recognition in a Grammy Award? Every little step
colluding successful song into successful book, what battles does he face that I cannot conceive of? From my distant, biased subjectivity. Look around. Whose version stands? Whose version circulates? Doubt, spiritual doubt. Proving existence. Severe belief, wild advocacy.
I've struggled for a while with how to proceed with regards to my relationship to pop music, so heavily inflected by oppression and appropriation. Governing thought is the question of to whose benefit the content as commodity works. Who profited and pushed? Whose labor was exploited or capitalized? Knowledge. These are general terms for general thoughts. Bono is the lead singer of the Irish band U2, constantly pushing the spectacle of their arena performances. In 2017, they will re-perform their album, The Joshua Tree, based on the feeling that musically and lyrically it is attuned to the times. Bono is also widely criticized for what is perceived to be the egocentric and cosmetic involvement with humanitarian campaigns in the so-called Third World. His work and legacy is not one that I turn to demonstrate what the cultural sector can do within society, though it is not a poor example either. On the U2 album, The Joshua Tree, there is a hit song titled, I Still Haven't Found What I'm Looking For, which functions as a pivot for the textual content of Phantom Cigarette. The vocalist, intoner, has climbed the highest mountains, run through the fields, run, crawled, scaled these city walls, only to be with you. Kissed honey lips, felt the healing in her fingertips, fingernails. It burned like fire, I was burning inside her. Speaking with the tongue of angels, holding the hand of a devil, I was cold as stone in the warmth of the night, believing in the kingdom come, all colors bleed into one. I'm still running. You carried the cross of my shame, broke the bonds, loosed the chain, but I still haven't found what I'm looking for, but I still haven't found what I'm looking for. The lyrics detail adversity or physical difficulty, all colors bleeding into one, bleed into one. Reasoning that it was only to be with you. So you too are not enough. What was it that he is looking for? Authenticity? Doubt? Walls come down. Playing characters. Playing at caring. Playing stadiums. Ego who? Ergo where? Techno update. Always changing. Someone else's song, but I'm doing it. Someone else's style, but I'm doing it. Tributes? Attributes? Passing on. Lines.
Look at me.
Young Whitney Houston sings a rendition of I Am Changing from Dreamgirls. A musical that allegedly draws from the life and times of Diana Ross. Crossover.
Try in every way I can. I am changing. I am changing.
Trying every way I can, I am changing. I'll be better
to find a way. I'm trying to find a way to
understand. But I need you, I need you, I need a hand. I am changing. Coming back to you too. You bring their inflection to gospel and roots, their own relationship to spirituality. Does gospel belong to any party? Contexts. Who claims rights and restitution? Soul rights, community restitution, copyright ergo, referencing, citing the fixed anchor points.
I am changing
continues.
I'll be better than I am. I'm trying.
Duty is to help another man, and that's the way it was planned. A woman help a man help a woman, a star help a star. Bono's charitable work, tax evasion, white disgust, bigger picture,
Whitney singing Dream Girls, a song from a semi-fiction of Diana Ross, which she doesn't endorse. When the film came out with Beyoncé starring as Dina, she could only say that she looked forward to seeing it with one of her lawyers. But regardless, she's glad to be seen as a titan and influence of the next generation. So what does it mean to dredge this up here with me in me? Different scales, different audiences, different contexts. One keeps an eye on scale within appropriation. Oh, when do we stand for naming it dedication? Performance? Context? Which archive am I handling? Repeating, Ronell, the only thing you can give is time. The only thing you can give to a problem, to an other, is time. There's nothing else to be given. It is the gift. Having a gift, giving a gift, symbolic altars. For the story that circulates, can you give gold, money? Do you know why I'm doing this? Do you know how much I'm being paid? Colesworthy Grant gives his testimony, describing the process of making a cake of dried indigo pigment in Bengal indigo plantations, 2,000 square feet of plants 6 feet high to produce an 8-ounce cake of pigment. Crushed indigo plants with clear river water overnight, a strange mottled appearance in color, principally of purple or coppery hues, partially covered with a bluish froth, then drained into the beating vat, appearing dull or bright orange, then spreading across the floor of the vat, the orange exchanged for a bright raw green, covered with a beautiful lemon-colored cream or froth. Michael Taussig writes that color is not only heat, but texture. Strange textures at that, such as yellow cream and yellow froth. Color is also heat and change. Taussig goes on to write about Goethe's experiments, heating objects, heating chocolate. The vat appears of greenish or bright olive, so that I am puzzled to tell you what precise color it really has. For being like the sea exposed to the sky, in like way its quantity and the state of the weather influence its appearance. When the beating commences, it generally presents a delicate light green complexion. This, through a variety of beautiful changes, gradually darkens into a Prussian green, and from that, as the beating continues, and the colouring matter more perfectly develops itself, the froth having almost entirely subsided into the intense deep blue of the ocean in stormy weather. Travelling shores, blue, saffron, sea green, saffron, blue, and saffron. The blue thread in the mummy cloths of ancient Egypt date from the 5th dynasty, which is to say around 2400 BC. The Old Testament filled with purple cloths, demanded by God for his first temple to be hung alongside heaps of gold and silver, 12,000 shellfish, for 1.4 grams of Tyrian purple. Dyeing cloth, dyeing metals, alchemy, turning, inhaling color, inhaling pigment. The purple phantom floating above a city. From a distance the world is blue and green, and the eagle takes to flight. Subdued registration, poured tar, a city of churches, and what song is heard? Coming to tears, because puppies. Whenever I see the color green, I remember that it is yellow and blue coming together. At the inception of this project, which skirts around the performance archive, we were interested in the notion of taxidermy in relation to the performance archive, taxidermy as colonial trophies. A process of selection, a process of murdering multiple specimens to only feature one, to only set the perfect specimen on the surface. There is also technique associated in preserving the specimen, and technique involved in making it appear most lifelike. This, in tandem with our Occidental fascination with the self-mummification of Buddhist monks who attempt Sokushinbutsu. 3 cycles of 1,000 days in which the body is stripped of what will rot it by gradually poisoning it. Success stories include drinking from a stream, a brook, a spring laced with arsenic,
drinking tea made from the lacquer tree, the bloodstream becoming something of lacquer, and retreating into a stone tomb, in which he sits in the lotus position and breathes through an air tube. He rings a bell daily. When he does not ring the bell, the air tube is removed. This was what he was looking for, through the extremity of pain, transcending the physical, to exist on a spiritual level, revered. Grubbly taking this idea to consider the self-mummification of the performance artist, reducing to an image, reducing to a trace of a context, left with a myth. Stadium tracking, smears of petrol on the asphalt, and crossing the road from a club night with a violent name to the Burger King, gay bash to Burger King, with no desire to order. I'm just there to watch a friend eat. A woman asks if she can raise my trouser leg. She's doing this to receive $50. And I ask what's in it for me. She says that I'll receive half. So I begin to pull up the stretched tartan. She asks if she can pull it up, and I suppose so. When my calf is revealed, she asks if she can lick it, and her asking in stages lulls a yes. We are in a public space, and as with all performance, there are too many subjectivities, egged on, thrilled by desire. My calf is licked. My anxiety about dry skin, the papery surface, probably not the issue for paying audience member. A long lick stripe like she's gonna roll the cigarette shut and light it. A shower of coins from her hands. The half I receive far exceeds what the whole was supposed to be. Triumphant that wonder my limbs can pay as such, I buy onion rings. I relish in sharing. Onion skins in rings, white smoke, smoky onion ring, no sauce, burnt in oil.